Welcome, everyone, to the first ever Latinx KidLit Book Festival. Our panel today is called Mirrors, Windows, and Sliding Glass Doors. My name is Aaron Aceves, and I am your moderator. I am also the author of This Is Why They Hate Us, a Latino, obviously, contemporary young adult novel coming spring 2022 from Simon & Schuster Books for Young Readers. I am so excited to be here, and I hope you are too. I do have to remind everyone, however, to please read our anti-harassment policy in the chat box. I will also do my best to keep my language kid-friendly because there are children watching this. Now let's get to our panelists. Up first, we have Olivia Abtahi, she, her. Olivia Abtahi is a writer and filmmaker based in Denver, Colorado. Born to an Iranian father and Argentinian mother, she is a mix of distinct cultures. Her debut novel, Perfectly Parvin, is set for spring 2021 publication through Penguin's Putnam Books for Young Readers, while her second book, Twin Flames, will be available fall 2021 from Two Books. In her spare time, Olivia enjoys binging music videos on YouTube, laughing so hard she can't breathe, and hitting 10,000 steps on her Fitbit. An accomplishment. Welcome, Olivia.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much, Aaron.
Of course, yeah. Next up, Daniel Aleman, he, him. Daniel Aleman was born and raised in Mexico City. A graduate of McGill University, he is passionate about books, coffee, and dogs, which I think is a great list. After spending time in Montreal and the New York City area, he now lives in Toronto, where he is on a never-ending search for the best tacos in the city. He is the debut author of Indivisible, a young adult novel coming on May 4th, 2021 from Little Brown Books for Young Readers. Hola, Daniel.
Hi, thank you so much for hosting us.
Of course. Then we have Emery Lee. Emery Lee is a KidLit author, artist, and YouTuber hailing from a mixed racial background. After graduating with a degree in creative writing, he's gone on to author novels, short stories, and webcomics. When away from reading and writing, you'll most likely find him engaged in art or snuggling cute dogs. I like this theme of dogs. Welcome, Emery.
Hi, thanks for having me. I'm really excited for this.
And last, we have Alda P Dobbs, she, her. Alda P Dobbs, I appreciate the middle initial solidarity, was born in a small town in northern Mexico, but moved to San Antonio, Texas as a child. She studied physics and worked as an engineer before pursuing her love of storytelling. She's passionate about connecting children to their past, their communities, cultures, and nature. Hi, Alda.
Hi, thank you for having me, Aaron.
Of course. So I'm like I said, I'm really excited to be doing this, and I'm really, really looking forward to all of your guys' books. And that brings me to my first question, which is, can you tell us a little about your books? How about we go in alphabetical order? So we're going to start with, by last name, we're going to start with Olivia.
Hey, everyone. My first book coming out next year, Perfectly Parvin, is about a half-Iranian half white protagonist who's struggling a little bit with her personality. So she decides to reinvent it based on her favorite romantic comedy films. But my second book coming out next year, Twin Flames, has Latina characters. It follows twins, Leila and Bianca, who are half Argentinian, half Iranian like me, as one of them grapples with a serious illness and the other one suddenly gets a newfound power from a djinn.
Awesome. Daniel, do you want to go next?
Yeah, of course. So Indivisible, which is coming next May from Books for Young Readers, follows the story of Mateo, a Mexican-American teenager who must care for his young sister after their parents are taken away by ICE. And while he tries to keep life as normal as possible for the two of them, he must face questions about his identity and about his own place in a country that rejects his mom and dad.
Awesome. Emery?
Yeah, so my book coming out next year is Meet Cute Diary. It's a trans rom-com about a triracial trans boy who runs a romance blog, but when the blog is threatened by a troll, he has to stage a fake romance in order to save it. And so it's basically just this fun rom-com about, you know, discovering yourself and connecting with your family and your friends and just generally having a good time. So that's May 4th, 2021 from HarperCollins/Quiltree.
you and Daniel share a release date then, right?
Yes.
May 4th. Awesome. That's so cool. And last but not least, Alda, do you want to talk about your book?
Sure. The title of my book is Barefoot Dreams of Petra Luna. It's about a 12-year-old mestizo girl in Mexico. And the backdrop is the Mexican Revolution in 1913 in Mexico. And it's about a girl who makes a promise to her dad to keep her family safe. And she has to get them to safety, to the safety of the U.S. border. And she crosses the desert, battlefields, in order to keep her promise. And she has these dreams that she hangs tied to, but she can't fulfill those dreams until she fulfills her promise. And Barefoot Dreams comes out sometime in the fall of 2021, and it's by Sourcebooks.
That's so cool. I think my family came over during the Mexican Revolution. Like, so that was when our history in the States began. And that's so cool. I'm looking forward to all of your books. So let's talk about them a little bit. So this panel is called Mirrors, Windows, and Sliding Glass Doors. When we refer to these types of books in KidLit, we mean that mirrors are books that reflect a reader's own identity or experience in some way. Windows are books that allow reader to see a different group of people that they are not a part of. And sliding glass doors are like windows, but they allow the reader sort of like a real, I don't want to say introduction, but real access to the culture or group of people. So relating to what I want to ask you that, guys, I'm curious about the first mirror that you all read, the first book that made you feel really seen in terms of your experience of Latinidad. And we'll start with Daniel there.
Of course. Well, I think the first time that I saw someone like myself, like a gay Mexican character, was in Adam Silvera's work. And of course, I have so much respect for Adam. The thing is, like, his first book, I think, came out when I was already in college. So I really went through so many of my teenage years and so many of the formative years without having that mirror. And that is, I think, why I'm so excited for all of our books and for, you know, the slow but short changes that we've seen in publishing over the last few years, because hopefully teenagers today will have a much wider offering of books that reflect their own experiences and that provide both mirrors and windows and sliding glass doors.
That's so awesome. I think if you're like a queer Latino like me, you kind of have to stan Adam Silvera.
100%.
Yeah, I think it was really interesting. Like, when I read More Happy Than Not, it was like the main character's name is Aaron. My name's Aaron.
I hadn't thought of that. Yeah.
And then it's so cool to see like so many people sort of being influenced by him and getting their own books out there, which is awesome.
Definitely.
All right. Next up.
It's actually I love that Daniel started with talking about Adam Silvera, because that's of course what I was going to talk about too. Because I think the first like queer Latinx story I read was actually Arian Dante, but I remember reading it and not connecting with it that much. Like it felt more like, I guess, like a glass door where I was, you know, kind of getting taken into this world, but it wasn't really my world. But I remember when I read More Happy Than Not, I was like, oh my God, like just like the dialogue, the things they did, like the way they approached everything, it just felt so like, and I mean, I'm Puerto Rican too. So like, I feel like it was very this is not just characters speaking Spanish. This is characters speaking Spanish that I know. Like, this is the Spanish that I know, you know, like this is like the way that like, they, you know, like the way that people, like when I growing up, the way people around me would act and the way we would think. And so I think it was very like, it was the first time, I think, at least in terms of like Latinidad, that I was like, that's actually what I know. Like, so that book for me was like a huge, like, I feel like that was like the first time that I read a book that I was like, oh my God, like I can actually write not just like the way that people expect me to explore my culture, but like the way that I actually know it. And that's like an acceptable thing to do. So that book honestly just changed my whole life.
That makes me so happy. Yeah, Ari and Dante, usually the first one, and then Adam Silvera, and then like, you guys are all expanding that, and that's so cool. Next up, Alda, do you want to talk about your first mirror?
Sure. I'd have to say, for me, it was Esperanza Rising, and the fact that it's about a Mexican girl, and that was the first time I'd seen a character being a migrant like myself and using vocabulary that I grew up with, and culture-wise, it was very similar to what I grew up, because I grew up in northern Mexico, so that protagonist also grew up in northern Mexico, and all the culture clash she had in America, which is also what I faced when I came here, when I moved to this country. So I enjoyed that book very much, even though I was a little, I was out of high school, way out of high school, but I enjoyed it a lot as a children's book.
Yeah, you're never too young, or you're never too old to read YA or middle grade, and I think that's why we all write it. Olivia?
Unfortunately, there hasn't been a seminal Iranian-Argentinian work out yet, so I kind of had to write my own. Growing up, the only kind of mix of Middle Eastern and South American was Shakira, if I'm being honest. So that's like really the only like icon I had. But yeah, I'm excited for my book Twin Flames to come out, because that is a book that grapples with identity in that way. And being half Argentinian, Argentina is a predominantly white country. So even though I'm also half Iranian, when I go down there, I don't look Argentinian at all. And people think I'm Arab. So I'm just really excited to have this opportunity to explore that culture a little bit more, and have something else, hopefully, besides Shakira for people to stand by.
Alrighty. Thank you, Olivia, so much, because you set me up really well for my next question. I want to talk about intersectionality in this case, because it's a Latinx Heritage Festival. Intersectionality is when your Latinx identity intersects with another part of your identity or another identity. Mirrors can reflect certain aspects of your identity, but not necessarily all of them. Kaysen Colander, a fantastic KidLit author that everyone should know, once tweeted about how they had never actually, similar to what Olivia was saying, they had never actually read a book that completely represented their identity until they wrote their own. And so Olivia talked about it a little bit, but I'm wondering if all of you can talk about how, you know, when you're writing your books, is that how you felt? Did you think, this is finally when I get to see myself in totality, in my complete, you know, intersection of identities? And going up first, we'll have Emery.
I actually love, like, yeah, like what Olivia said, because I feel like that was so, like, true. Like, I feel like the more marginalized identities you have, the harder it is to ever feel like you're being represented. And I know that was a big thing for me, and it's something that, like, I remember when Kaysen made that thread, I had told them, like, I was like, you know, even the book that I'm writing, I'm not fully represented in totality, you know, like, I wrote a triracial main character because I've never seen a triracial main character before. And I've asked so many people for recommendations, and people will give me, you know, multicultural characters, or like, you know, like all these like things that they think is what I mean when I say triracial. I'm like, no, I mean, I want a character who is, you know, triracial. Like, Noah is white, he's Black, and he's Asian. And he's also Latinx, he's Puerto Rican as well. But like his identity, like it's still not my full identity. Like I actually like censored out, like, even though racially he and I are the same, culturally we're not. I actually only put a couple of my cultures into his identity, because I feel like, you know, at the end of the day, like, publishing is not, you know, it is not the most diverse place you can be. And very often you find that stories only allow the room for maybe one or two identities. And so even just, you know, to sell a story about a character who's triracial, who's trans, and then by the end of the book, he determines that he's bi, that was already a lot. And so, like, you know, I'm Arrow Ace. I didn't make Noah Arrow Ace. I didn't include, you know, my disabilities. I didn't include, you know, many of my cultures. And it just kind of came down to, you know, even as we're expanding, even as we're allowing more stories to exist and more, you know, intersections to become like a real thing, sometimes it feels like if you add too many things, that eventually becomes nothing at all. You know, like, can this character who has so many cultures and so many identities appeal to somebody who only has one of those cultures or one of those identities? And so, you know, when you are so, you know, marginalized, so intersectionally marginalized, I think sometimes you can't even write your own mirror. You know, you don't even feel safe doing so. And there's always the risk that in doing so, you'll alienate other readers. And so, so my answer to that is, I have never seen a mirror, a true mirror. And I'm to this day, I'm not even writing one. And I do hope that one day I'll feel like comfortable and welcome to do so. But I think that for the most part, it ends up being, you know, you kind of learn to put as much of yourself into something as you feel you can do safely. And then the rest is, you know, you save it for another book. So that's kind of been my experience.
Gotcha. I've always hoped that, like, when you are representing multiple identities, you know, even if they're not all of yours, that having one in common with a reader would be enough for them to relate to. And that's been the case when I've been reading. And so I think there are a lot of people who are going to relate to your book. And I hope that one day, you know, you can explore all of your identities. And I'm sure it's going to be a lot of fun. Next up, Alda, do you want to talk about your intersectional identity and, you know?
Sure. Yeah, the title of my book, Barefoot Dreams of Petra Luna, the barefoot, I was trying to, more of a mirror to myself is more of a mirror for the way my great-grandma and my grandmother lived and how they grew up. Because they were the poorest of the poor. There were women back in 1913 in Mexico. And in my writing, I wanted to create that world, bring their lives to the present through my writing. And the barefoot, of course, because they, like I said, they are barefoot, they're poor. And it was more of a mirror for them than for me. But just like Emery said, that in writing a book, yourself comes into the story without you knowing. You pour yourself into it, you expose yourself. So there is part of you in that book. But my aim was to bring about my great-grandma and my grandmother's story into play, since they are the ones who inspired the book. So that's my mirror.
That's so cool. And like, it, you know, you're honoring them in that way. And that's really awesome. Next up, Olivia.
I always use this metaphor, and I need to find a new one. But when you're from so many different marginalizations, like Emery was talking about, like, it feels like a horcrux when you're like putting like just a fragment of your soul into a book. You don't get to share like the full soul experience. That said, it is really cathartic. It feels really good to put on the page, you know. And my first book coming out next year, Perfectly Parveen, you've got a character who's half Iranian, half white. You know, her mom isn't Latina like my mom is, but it just felt really good. And it was so nice to just have one of those intersectionalities together. And to already have half Iranian kids, you know, come to me and say like, whoa, I can't wait. Like, I need this book in my life. And then for Twin Flames, to have twins who, it was really great having twins, because I can just put a bit of myself into each one, that are like not the same thing. So, you know, one is dealing with an illness and the other is dealing with her sexuality. And it felt really good to have that on the page, you know, along with their heritage, that's the same as mine. You know, they're not the daughters of asylum seekers or political refugees like my parents, but it's still, it just felt like such a gift. And I feel like, I don't know, I really needed to write these books into my life. And even if they hadn't been published, I would still keep these books in, you know, a printed manuscript, like under my bed, just because it makes me feel so happy to know that it's finished and out there. So to answer like your question, like it just feels really good to have it out there in the world.
That's so, I'm just gonna keep saying that's so cool, because like I'm really, like it's heartwarming to hear these answers. And then last but not least, who hasn't gone yet?
Sorry, Daniel.
Hi. Olivia, I loved what you said about it feeling like cathartic, portraying parts of your identity on the page, because that for me was what writing Indivisible was, through the eyes of Mateo. I feel like I did set out to write a gay Mexican kid, but I didn't quite realize how much of myself I was almost unconsciously putting on the page until I was editing the book and until I was rereading it. And I was like, oh my God, this reads like my diary almost in certain parts.
And that was such a wonderful thing for me. Like, I feel like the book is in and of itself an exploration of Mateo's identity as a Mexican American and as someone whose parents are facing immigration issues. And I feel like for me, it was also an exploration of myself and of my identity and my place in the world. And I'm so excited to share that next spring, because I hope that teenagers who need it and who need that mirror and who perhaps haven't been able to find it yet will be able to access it.
Awesome. Yes, if you are watching and these people seem cool to you, they should. then go ahead and go pre-order their books. They're coming out in 2021. It's going to be a lit year for KidLit. So I want to ask a question, and it wasn't in the questions I sent you guys, and I hope it's okay that we're riffing a little bit and coming off script. But I want to know about sort of the seeds of your books, the initial ideas, and sort of the, I don't want to say hoops, but I'm going to say hoops, the hoops you had to go through to get the book deal, to get to, you know, your book coming and hitting shelves in 2021. And the reason I'm asking this, and I'll give you some time to think by telling my story. So my book is This Is Why They Hate Us, and it's about a Chicano kid. He's bi, so like we share our identities. And like one of the things I didn't even consider really was the language, because growing up, I told you that like with Alda's story, I'm like, I think my family came in the early 1900s. So like over time, we've like lost Spanish. We don't really, you know, have too many words that have stuck around. And so like one thing I didn't think about was like when they're at home, they're speaking English, they'll pepper in like little Spanish phrases that have like, you know, survived. But while I was getting feedback on it from agents and agent assistants, someone once asked me, why aren't they speaking Spanish at home? And like, it was this moment of just feeling so like unseen, you know, like, and just being like my answer was, because I exist, because my family exists, you know, like this is our experience. And like, there's people who just think like this, you have this monolithic view of Latinidad. And so I was wondering if you guys want to commiserate and if you want to tell us about, you know, the beginnings of your book and you know, going through that publishing process. And hopefully it wasn't, you know, hard, too hard, but you know, we live in this world. and we can start with, well, does anyone feel strongly about that? Olivia, do you want to go?
Yeah. First of all, like, I'm sorry that happened to you. That really is not a good feeling to have someone kind of police how they think your identity should play out on the page. But yeah, I had a very roundabout path to publishing. The first book I wrote is Twin Flames, even though that's the second book that'll be published. And I had a lot of agents say, I just don't know how to sell this book. You know, this is during the Marvel movie craze, and I wanted like a superhero story with someone who looked like me. And a lot of agents said, you know, I don't know how to sell a Iranian Argentinian like superhero, like Muslim, like origin story. And I had, I want to say like 25 requests for manuscripts, and all of them were turned down, which is like a very strange percentage. And in the end, I submitted the manuscript to an open call over at Lee and Lowe, who's just a wonderful multicultural publisher, and they took a chance on me. So there were agents who said that they didn't feel comfortable taking a chance on me, and I had to go straight to the source with an editor. So I totally feel your pain. And I just think it's really interesting that sometimes, you know, identities just aren't commercial. And it's really interesting who says yes and who says no to you.
Does anyone else feel strongly?
I can go next. I was gonna say, like, I think for Me Cute Diary, it wasn't too bad. I'll say, especially I think at the querying stage, agents were pretty understanding. My previous books that I had queried, those went badly. I had a lot of feedback from like readers who would say things essentially like, you know, this isn't believable, this isn't, you know, authentic. And you know, they were literally just things that like were completely like my life, and they'd be like, that's not authentic. And I'd be like, what's authentic then? I did have the, with Me Cute Diary, I had not so much on the like cultural elements, but I did have some on some of the queer elements. Things like Noah throughout most of the book identifies as gay, but he says that he's gay, but that he's still into, like he's still occasionally attracted to women, but he identifies as gay. And later on in the book, he's like, you know, a friend says, well, that sounds kind of bi. And he's like, okay, fine. You know, I guess maybe I'll use bi then. And I had someone be like, is that appropriate? Can you have him say that when he's, and I was like, who cares? I mean, it's his sexuality. Like, I mean, I say I'm gay sometimes, and sometimes I say I'm bi, and sometimes I say I'm pan, and it honestly, it varies, you know, like it's just, sexuality is so fluid, and it's so, you know, so dependent on who you are and like how you feel about yourself more than anybody else's take on it. So I did definitely have some of that too, where they were, people would kind of be like, you can't do that. And I'm like, but I just did. I do this all the time. Like this is, you know, this is real for me. So, yeah, I think that's unfortunately a really common experience. I think that just, you know, people kind of go based on what they've heard and what they've been told. And so they try to tell you, you know, well, someone told me that you shouldn't do this, so you shouldn't do this. But like, you know, not realizing that when this is your real life experience, and this is something that you're putting into a story, like it's okay. Like if you know, that person's friend doesn't agree with it, but like, but it's my life, you know, and I'm not gonna change who I am or censor my life because it doesn't agree with like your experience per se, so.
Period. Daniel or Alda, do you have a story to share?
Well, I feel like similar to you, Emery, my experience was with previous books that I'd queried, I'd encountered a lot more challenges. I feel it also to the queer element. And I queried at some point a book that dealt with, you know, the pain of like queer pain. And it was very much a me book, and it was very much related to my feelings and my experience. And I felt like it was just, I mean, it was well received by a lot of people, but by other people, it felt like, ironically, by mostly straight agents, they didn't feel comfortable pursuing that kind of story. With Indivisible, however, I have been very, very lucky to have a very supportive team. And I feel like my agent and my editors have really respected my vision and have really trusted my vision when I'm talking about my character and when I'm talking about his family and when I'm talking about, you know, my views on being Mexican and being gay. And I feel very lucky to have that, because I know that there are a lot of challenges out there, and there are a lot of people who face a lot of difficult stuff out there in this industry. So I feel lucky from my own experience.
Well, I'm glad you had that experience. That makes me happy. And Alda?
One thing that sticks in my mind is when one person that read my manuscript said that they couldn't believe that all the children were barefoot back then, the poor children. And they kept asking, are they all barefoot? They're all barefooted? And I said, yeah. And they said, even in the wintertime? I said, yeah, they had no money. They had no shoes. And they were kind of skeptical. They wouldn't believe it, that they could conceive that the fact that these people were, like I said, they were destitute. They had no money. They barely scraped by to survive, especially during the war. And literally thousands of people were, especially the children, were barefoot. That's just the way it was. So that intrigued me. And also that the fact that they kept saying that my story was too quiet. I had some people pass on it because they said nothing happened. And, while this kid is going through war and whatnot. So, but I kept pursuing it until I found the perfect editor. My agent found the perfect editor and matched us both, and she fell in love with it. And she believes there's a lot going on in that book and that story. So that's just to teach you, you know, that not to give up. So.
People's opinions on your book can be so funny. Cause like I got the too quiet critique. I got the actually, so Enrique in my book, he's Chicano and he's bi, and I got the critique that the book itself was biphobic because he's only interested in boys throughout the entire book, and it was reinforcing the stereotype that bi guys are actually just gay. And I was like, but I, me, And then this, on Twitter, people were talking about like people who are too scared to write own voices because they'll get these type of critiques that aren't just chipping away at like your craft, but also like your experience of being, marginalized identity. So I'm really glad to have this conversation with you guys because, just good looks all around. All right, so my last question before we get to the Q&A is, what are your, and I'm just really excited to get the answers to this, what are your wildest dreams for your book? I wanna know about your aspirations for a Netflix adaptation, an amusement park, like that kind of stuff, obviously, like all the fun stuff. But also I wanna know like, what your hopes are for the teenagers who read your books and if you think your book is gonna change lives, like based on like what I've heard of them, like I really think they are. And I wanna hear you guys talk about like that really fun, cool stuff. And we can start with Alda.
All right, well, a theme park would be nice, if everyone's barefoot in that theme park, but I hope that changes is that there's so many Mexican Americans like yourself, Aaron, that can trace their family to the Mexican Revolution, and a lot of people don't realize just the ties to that event and how it started the wave of immigration from Mexico and even from Central America to the United States. And also what I'm hoping is that kids, it entices kids to kind of search for where their ancestors came from, whether it be Europe, Asia, or Africa, or the Americas. I want them to start to kind of get them hungry to find out more about their ancestors and see what they all went through to get here and elsewhere as well. Whatever migration stories or war stories, I want them to be hungry for those answers, because as soon as that generation passes, those stories are gone. So that's what I'm hoping, that kids will go out there and ask the questions.
Great, and next up we have Olivia.
I actually am lucky to have one of my like wildest hopes and dreams for my book come true. I look related to the kids on my book. That's never happened before. There, I don't think has been an Iranian American like photo or a model on a young adult book in this country. So that like, I'm just gonna cry like talking about it now. But yeah, I like that girl could be my cousin. That's like the best feeling in the world. And then I think, just having another reader feel seen with a capital S, like, as they read it, it's like one of my wildest hopes and dreams. And then just two like random ones would be, I would love for my books to be translated into Farsi, which is kind of tricky just with like Iran and like the copyright laws there and the way publishing would translate. And then I would love to be invited to the Buenos Aires Book Festival, so I get to see my family. And I don't know, I just hear it's a wonderful book festival, and that's like just something that I put in my little dream journal.
Daniel?
So I'd say my biggest dream would be a film adaptation, but we'll see. We'll see what happens in the future. And also to see this book translated to Spanish, because there are so many of my friends and family back in Mexico who want to support me, and they're like, they don't speak English, and I want to be able to hand them this book in Spanish, and that would be so special to me. And in terms of what I hope readers will get from it, I think I could sum it up, and I want people who read it to feel less alone. I hope that it reaches people who need it, who need to see part of themselves or part of their experience, and to feel, as Olivia said, seen with a capital S.
That's so lovely. Emery?
So I actually had to like really think about this one, because usually I have like this whole idea of like an anime adaptation or something, but like, this is a contemporary, it's a rom-com. They don't really do anime that doesn't take place in Japan, like it takes place in Colorado. I finally came up with what I wanted. I want somebody to design a line of clothes like inspired by like the characters, like just like an entire fashion line. And this could be like formal wear, it can be like, casual wear, whatever, but I want it like inspired by the characters. Like I wanted to capture like their whole like vibe and aesthetic like in like a fashion line. That is what I want. And as far as like, you know, what I want readers to like feel, I guess I want readers to like feel like we can have our happily ever after. Like, you're not too brown or too black or too queer to have like just like these pure, happy, like fun stories. Like, you know, you don't, it doesn't have to be like, you know, miserable. Like, being queer is awesome and it's fun, and like being trans is exciting, and like, you know, you can go out and you can have like this perfect romance, and like, you deserve that. And I just want readers to finally like have that kind of like, I guess, you know, an outside voice telling them that, instead of constantly having to like, you know, reaffirm that for themselves. Like, I want somebody else to say, you know, you can be happy. And so I said it.
I love that. All right, so we've reached the Q&A portion of the panel, and I think our first cue is a video question from a real student out there in the world. Let's watch.
Hi, I'm Paige, and I was wondering if there was any specific book or author that inspired you to write your own book.
Cool. Does anyone want to answer Paige first? Olivia.
I think one of the books that inspired me to write my more Iranian American novel is called Darius the Great Is Not Okay by Adib Khoram. That was, I think I read it 3 years ago. I think it came out now. I was on a plane and I just broke down sobbing, like just heaving, and like, you know, people looking at me in the aisles. And it was because I just felt that part of my identity felt so, you know, seen and recognized. And that book really inspired me to, I mean, this is embarrassing to say, but when I first started writing, I would make all my characters white because that's all that I read. And I never thought someone could do that, I guess. So yeah, Adib Khoram's book, Darius the Great Is Not Okay. And then right after that, another author, Tahereh Mafi, had a sequel to one of her fantasy books. It was called Witchwood, and that was also based on Iranian folklore. And without those books, I don't know, I was like, oh, maybe I can write about one side of me. And then as I kept doing it, I was like, maybe I can write about both sides of me. Like, that would be, that's crazy. Like, can I do it? Can I pull it off? And then just all of these other authors really gave me the courage to do that.
That's so cool. I also read Darius on a plane, and I like felt like I was in Iran. Like, I was like, I didn't even notice that I was on a plane. I was like, no, I'm like here. And then it's so impressive because he's never been there. And he just like wrote this book. Ah, it's incredible. The power of research. Emery, do you want to go?
Yeah, sure. So I sound like a broken record, but the biggest influence behind Miku Diary was actually the book What If It's Us by Adam Silvera and Becky Albertalli. And it was like the first time that I had read, I think, a book that I was like, this is so like happy and fun. And like, it felt like growing up, I was always like a comedy movie type of person. Like, I only like generally like comedies or like animated movies. And so like, I feel like as I got older, I started watching a lot more dark stuff. And I feel like that was the only place that I started to see like people of color and like queer people in general was like, you know, darker books and like darker movies and like that kind of stuff. There wasn't a lot of stuff that was just pure joy. And I mean, What If It's Us has a little bit of like some darker elements, but it wasn't like an issue book, and it wasn't like, oh, like you're all just gonna sit here and, you know, deal with the homophobia the entire time. And so when I was like found out that I could do that, I was like, oh my god, I can do that. And so it just kind of like became this whole like spiral of like, oh my god, I have to do that. How do I do that? And then just like throwing my own identities into the mix and like recreating that like element, but just with somebody who like looked a little more like me and acted a little more like me. And then that was essentially how I got Miku Diary.
Awesome. Daniel?
For me, I don't feel like there was any specific book, but I feel like it was seeing bits and pieces of myself in different books. So for example, as you mentioned, Emery, Becky Albertalli and Adam Silvera, I think it was finding pieces of myself in books by these authors that inspired me to be like, okay, now I want to see all of myself. I want to write about a gay Mexican kid whose parents are immigrants. And that's how this story came to be.
And Alda?
All right, well, it wasn't on a plane where I read this book. It was actually in a public bus. But when I was 17, on my way to work. Can you see me? All right. On my way to work, I came across a book that was next to me, and it was Catcher in the Rye. And I started reading that book, and I wasn't into reading books or whatnot. I was working full time. I was in high school trying to juggle a lot of things in life during that time. And that's the first book I actually read from cover to cover. And I was just amazed at how the author had captured the essence of the teen. And I felt identified through that one teen. And I, for the first time, that's when I thought, maybe I can do this. Maybe this is, because I've always liked storytelling. And that's what put the seed in my head. And it would take another 18 years before I gave it a shot. But that's probably the one book that started it, that put it in my head about maybe one day I could write a book too. That's where it wasn't a plan, it was a buzz, but pretty similar.
That's awesome. Our second question is also a video question. It's coming to us from Virginia.
How are you all working on normalizing your LGBTQI+ characters? Are you working on not using cisnormative language like ladies and gentlemen and his or her as the only options for pronouns?
Such a great question. I think we're going to start with Emery here.
Okay, so I mean that I feel like that question is like so innately like I guess a part of MeCute Diary, because the whole I mean as a writer in general, I always tell people that when you're writing, you have to question your defaults, and that means like you know it's not just about who's on the page, but it's about who's welcome on the page and what you consider to be normal. And as long as you're writing a book where like whiteness is normal, where cis straightness is normal, like it will always read to, you know, people who don't fit those defaults, like they're not necessarily welcome there. So with MeCute Diary, one of the things I really wanted to do was just make it so blatantly clear to everybody that like, you know, queer people are not weird. We're not like, you know, we're not outsiders. We're not like abnormal. We are like just as much a part of like the world, and we should be considered in like people's basic defaults. And so like, I even have like a scene where Noah's working at this summer camp, and there's like all these kids, and this person that he's working with basically has them go around and say like their name and something that they like and say their pronouns. And Noah was kind of like, oh, like, why are you having them say their pronouns? And like, the coworker's kind of like, well, you know, they may be kids, but like one day they're going to grow up and they're going to realize these things. They're going to come to terms with their own identities. And by normalizing it now, by making it like, making them aware that they can do that, they can question those things. Like that's how they learn. And that's how they eventually grow into questioning these things and feeling like it's normal and safe to do so. And so like I have a character change pronouns multiple times throughout the book. And I have, you know, several times where Noah kind of like looks at a group of people and says, you know, I think these people might be women, but I'm not sure. Like, I can't tell for sure, you know, and just things like that, where it's kind of like, you know, don't just look at somebody and assume that everybody is cis straight and like allosexual, and like, just, you know, look at people and like realize that like, you know, we are all different. And so as long as you're holding these defaults and this idea that people, you know, have to fit into this box, otherwise they're abnormal, you know, it's just a very like, I feel like it's a very difficult thing to unlearn, but I feel like as it becomes normalized to kind of like question those defaults, I think that's how you start to make the community a lot safer for people who don't fit, you know, the standard of like what is considered like acceptable.
Question the defaults. Yeah. Daniel, Olivia, Alda, do you guys have any thoughts on this?
I'd love to answer. Well, Indivisible is a book that where Mateo, the main character, questions a lot of parts about his identity, but it was really important for me to like that his sexuality was not one of those aspects that he questioned. I think like there's just an acceptance of Mateo as a gay teenager in his world, and that was really important to me to normalize this and to have him be his full self when it comes to being gay.
Awesome. Olivia, do you have any thoughts on this?
Sorry, y'all. There's a screaming baby in the background. I've got an 8-week-old. It kind of merges with your previous question, but I had to fight really hard to have a character be pansexual in my book. There were some people who felt like they need to be bi, and I had to explain, like, no, like, this... person also, you know, is attracted to gender non-binary folks. So yeah, that's just something that's always in the back of my head. How can I make this more inclusive? How can I make sure that I'm not just staying within this heteronormative binary? Because even though this particular book is for 14-year-olds, like Emery says, that's something that we need to be thinking about now.
Awesome. And Alda?
The story that I did is a historical fiction, so it's based in 1913, and I try to stay true to the realm and the era, the time. So I work with the characters to what was current, and you know, as hard as it is because of the present time, I try to distance myself from the present and just stay authentic to that voice of that era, of that time.
Gotcha. All right, we have our next possibly final question, we shall see, from Aiden F., who is in the eighth grade and is from Texas. And Aiden would like to know, Alda, how did you come up with Petra Luna's name?
It's interesting, great question. There's the theme, one of the themes in the books are coal, because it's a coal region. It's a, they call it Región Carbonífera in Mexico. So they mine a lot of coal. And I figured since we talk about rocks and a lot of rocks are mentioned, I gave it the name Petra, which is means rock in Greek. And I've always liked the name Petra. It sounds very strong. And I wanted to give her a soft name. And first thing that came to me, the last name, the soft last name was Luna. So I figured that'd be the great match, Petra Luna. And the name just feels so familiar now. It feels like she's a relative of mine by now. So that's how I came up with the name. Thank you for the question.
Yeah, no, that's so cool because there was a lot behind that name. All right, so we have time for another question. I'm going to, it's not for me, but I'm going to ask this question. What book, other than your own, I like that they assume that you're going to pitch your own book right now, but what book other than your own would you recommend and why? Let's start with Daniel.
I'll be really quick. I would recommend Furia by Jamile Sayed Mendes, which I absolutely love.
Olivia?
Coming in 2021 is Victories Greater Than Death by Charlie Jane Anders. Just an incredible book set in space. I would call it a gender fluid space opera. Can't wait for y'all to read it.
Nice. Emery?
Also coming in 2021 is 1500 Miles from the Sun by Johnny Garcia. It's literally one of the best books I've ever read. Queer Mexican main character. You will love him. He's adorable. I highly recommend.
How did I know you were going to say that? Alda, what book would you recommend?
It's a book I recently read, and it's called The Queen of Water. It's by Laura Riso and Maria Virginia Farinango. And it talks about Virginia's life as a little girl in Ecuador. And she grew up very poor, and her parents sent her off to be a servant, to work as a servant. And it's all the trials and small joyful moments she had, and just how she dealt with everything. It's a beautiful book, beautifully written. So I highly recommend the Queen of Water.
Awesome. All right, so we're coming up right against the edge of our time. So I want to give you all a chance to plug your social media. We'll start with Emery.
So I'm on Twitter at Emery Lee Hu. I'm also on Instagram at Emery Lee Hu is my art account, and at Emery Lee Books is my book account. And I'm also on YouTube. It is a break from reality. T, like reality is like a T pun, so T-E-A.
Gotcha. Olivia?
I'm on Twitter at Olivia Abtahi and also on Instagram at Olivia Abtahi.
Awesome. Alda?
I'm on Facebook, Alda P Dobbs, and my website is aldapdobbs.com. Thank you.
And Daniel?
I'm on Twitter at Dan_Aleman, Instagram Dan Aleman, and you can also visit me at danielaleman.com.
Awesome. I am Aaron H. Aceves on Twitter and Aaron Aceves, minus the middle initial, on Instagram. I want to give No, that's why I already did that. Okay. I want to thank all of the organizers of the first ever Latinx KidLit Book Festival. Thank you guys so much for putting this together, particularly Ismay and Rachel. Thank you so much for handling all the tech stuff. Thank you, panelists. This was a lovely conversation. It would not have been as lovely if it had been some other people who aren't you guys. I want to thank the viewers, anyone who is watching this right now. I want to thank you guys for attending Mirrors, Windows, and Sliding Glass Doors. This has been the Latinx KidLit Book Festival. Adios, guys.
Thank you.